The remaining five criteria are the same for the man and the woman. The second is the clothes they wear, it should not be so tight so that it reveals the figure, it should be loose. The third is it should not be translucent or transparent so that you can see through. The fourth is it should not be so glamorous so that it attracts the opposite sex. Fifth, it should not resemble that of the unbeliever. And sixth, it should not resemble that of the opposite sex. These are basically the six criteria. And most of these six criteria are even mentioned in the other scriptures. If you read the Bible, it's mentioned in the Bible in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 22, verse number 5. It says that the woman shall not wear clothes that which pertaineth to a man, and a man shall not wear clothes that which pertaineth to a woman. All those who do this, they are creating an abomination. It's further mentioned in the Bible in the 1 Timothy, chapter number 2, verse number 9, that the woman should be dressed up with shamefacedness and sobriety. They should not wear costly array, pearls and gold. And further it's mentioned in the 1 Corinthians, chapter number 11, verse number 5 to 6, that the woman that prayeth with the head uncovered, her head should be shaved off. There's no verse in the Quran and the Hadith which says that the woman who does not cover her head should be shaved off. But the Bible is stricter. Bible is stricter than the Quran. That if the woman that prays does not cover the head should be shaved off. The same thing in the Hindu scripture. If you read the Hindu scriptures, it's mentioned in Ramayana that when Pasuram, when he comes to Ram, he says to his wife Sita that he's the elder. Therefore, lower your gaze and guard your modesty. It's further mentioned if you read Rig Veda, book number 10, chapter number 85, verse number 30. It says that the woman who wears the clothes of that of a man, she is defiling it. She should not wear the clothes of a man. Further, it's mentioned that in Rig Veda, book number 8, that Brahma has ordered that the woman should cover her head. So in Hindu scriptures, Christian scriptures, Muslim scriptures, modesty is there, covering the head is there. By the passage of time, I do agree with you that Christianity now, you only see the nuns covering the head. They are called pious. If Muslim women cover their hair, they are called as subjugated. Why? Double standards. If you see a nun covered properly, therefore you see the photograph of Mother Mary. Have you seen the photograph of Mother Mary? Like a Muslima. And she was a Muslima, Muslim woman. Properly covered, with the wrist, only face seen. What I do agree with you, if you stick to the six criteria, by fashion, the types of hijab, the burqa, abaya has changed. As long as you follow the six principles of Islam and you change the color from black to blue to brown, no problem. As long as you don't break any of the six criteria, therefore you see new styles of hijab. But some styles of burqa, they are so fashionable that they break the law of Islam. There are so many shiny sequences coming that you're attracting the opposite sex. So that is haram. But otherwise, you want to wear red, you want to wear black color, no problem. People think black is compulsory. Black is not compulsory. If you wear black, maybe you may have to wash the burqa once in a week. If you wear white, you may have to wash every day. The choice is yours. You wear white and wash it every day. You wear black and wash it once a week. Choice is yours. As long as it doesn't break any of the criteria, six criteria of hijab. So now there are new types of hijab coming. As long as it doesn't break, you're allowed. But it should be modest. If it's modest, it's accepted. Second question. That you see in Ramadan, that people fast. When they fast in the day, in the evening they feast. And I would like to thank you for asking this question. See, why do we fast? Allah says in the Quran in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 183, that fasting has been prescribed to you as it was prescribed to people who came before you, so that you may learn self-restraint. You may learn taqwa. And today, scientists they tell us, if you can control your hunger, you can control almost all your desires. So if you can fast, you can control your other desires. But I do agree with you, if not all, many Muslims, if you say most also, I would not mind agreeing with you, that they fast, and when they break the fast, they feast. So that defeats the purpose, I do agree with you. And many of them convert the day into night and night into day. They sleep the full day, and the full night they're playing cricket. in India cricket. So you have to lead a normal life, like a normal life. You have to do more ibadah, you have to worship God more. So normally when you fast, but naturally your meals are reduced, it is medically beneficial. But if you overeat, then there'll be a problem. But if you do it the correct way, there are various medical benefits of fasting, which you can refer to my video cassette. And I've given 64 episodes on fasting, which come during Ramadan. And inshallah, you can watch the various benefits of fasting. Hope that answers the question.
Sister Saeed, if you have a question from a non-Muslim sister, could you please state it?
Assalamu alaikum. This is on behalf of a non-Muslim, Sister Vandana. She says, I'm new to this concept, have limited knowledge, therefore asking a basic question. If out of 6,000 verses, 1,000 are about scientific facts, then what really is the essence of the Quran?
Sister, that's a very good question. That if the Quran contains more than 6,000 verses, and more than 1,000 speak about science, what is the essence of the Quran? Sister, as I mentioned in my earlier answer, the basic essence of the Quran is Tawheed. Believing in one God and worshipping Him alone and no one else. And the Quran, as I mentioned, is not a book of science, S-C-I-E-N-C-E. It's a book of signs, S-I-G-N-S. It's a book of ayats. The Quran is a book which shows you how a life should be led. And when I had a debate with Shri Ravi Shankar, I said, this is the best book on art of living. If there is any book on art of living which is the best, it is the Quran. Best book on art of living. And it has a membership of more than 1.3 billion people. So this book shows you how to lead a life. Now, many a time you understand that because the Quran is the word of Almighty God, one verse of the Quran has got multiple angles. Now, the same 1,000 verses which are speaking about science, it doesn't mean it only speaks about science. It speaks about various other aspects also. That's the beauty of the Quran. When a layman sees it, he understands it. When a scientific man sees it, he sees it in a different angle. It satisfies both. So that's the beauty of the Quran. That does not mean the Quran is a book of science. Yes, but there is not a single verse of the Quran which goes against established science. Because it's a book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Almighty God. So this book is a book of guidance, how a life should be led. It shows a person to believe in oneness of God, how to worship Him, and how to lead the life. The pros and cons, the faraiz, what a human being should do, and the prohibited things that he should abstain from. It's mentioned in the Quran. Hope that answers the question, sister.
The sister could please stay at the microphone. I'll come back to you after I take a question from the gentleman's side. If you have more questions from non-Muslims. If there's another sister who has a question, non-Muslim, then please allow her to come to the mic and ask her question as well. But until then, I'll go with the brother in the front